That'll be a mile.
Yeah.
We're in Revelation 2 tonight. Revelation 2. I want to encourage you guys, memorize Scripture. I don't know what other incentive you need. Brother Taj is going to run a mile and memorize the same Scripture for every verse you memorize. And if you don't take him up on that kind of a deal, what kind of deal do you want? What do you want? Nothing ought to make anyone happier than Taj running. About who?
Goo running.
Goo running? It just doesn't quite get me as happy.
How about one word, 1 mile? Thank you.
One word, 1 mile. Listen, if you can't memorize a verse of the Scripture for a mile of running, anyway, it's a great deal. Take them up on it. We're in Revelation chapter 2 this evening, and we're really fresh into our series in Revelation. I'm looking forward to the next couple of months having an opportunity of a really expounding on this portion of the Scripture. Truthfully, Revelation is probably the most often preached portion of the Scripture, most often out of context, unscripturally, unbiblically. If you turn on the comedy channel, or I should say the Christian channel, TBN, on your television, and you watch the average sermon, most of what's being talked about or preached about is prophecy, and most of the prophecy is purported to be from Revelation, and very little of it actually is what the Scripture's teaching. I remind you, as we began our series a couple of weeks ago, that when John was told by the Lord or by the angel to write the things which he has seen, the things which are and the things which shall be hereafter, he was told, "Blessed is he that readeth," or he said, "Blessed he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand." And Revelation is a revealing of a mystery. So Revelation is not mysterious. Revelation sheds light on mysteries. And so it's a portion of the Scripture that you would go to and find answers for other portions of the Scripture. So it's not meant to be mysterious. I will say that the Revelation is the portion of the Scripture that causes me to wish that I were an artist, because it is so figurative when it describes events. For instance, in my mind's eye, as we begin to read our text this evening, in my mind's eye, I see the thing very vividly. I see the Lord Jesus standing in the midst of 7 golden candlesticks. And I see it like a map. I don't know if you've ever looked at a map of the 7 churches, but if you look over here and you see a little dot on a map, which is an island called Patmos, where John is exiled and where he receives the revelation, you find that in order, as they're mentioned in the Scripture, you see the churches beginning at Ephesus and going around in a circle like this, the 7 churches. You find them on a map, and you can see the order that the Holy Spirit gave them in. It was very orderly. So it began with Ephesus, and then Smyrna, and then Pergamos, and then Thyatira, and so on and so forth as you go around on the map. And I see the Lord Jesus kind of standing on this map of this portion of Asia, and the portion of Asia having candlesticks, and the Lord Jesus standing right there in the midst of them. My friend, this is not symbolic merely. This is an evidence that the Lord Jesus Christ is in the midst of His churches. See, we have the Holy Spirit of God, who is representative of the Spirit of Christ. Many times in the New Testament, we see God's Spirit referred to as the Spirit of Christ. It's the same Spirit that Jesus promised when He said before going to the cross that I will not leave you comfortless, but another, and He's speaking another of the same kind. In other words, the Holy Spirit is not representative of His own personality. He represents Him. He represents Jesus and the ministry that Jesus had with His disciples. And so the Spirit of Christ is present among us here today. My friend, physically speaking, God the Father and God the Son are in heaven. God the Father is sitting on His throne. God the Son is sitting on His right hand. And God the Holy Spirit is literally here. And He's present with us, and He is representing Jesus. And when we talk about Jesus coming into your heart, we're talking about the Spirit of God coming in you, representing Jesus. And so if you think about the ministry that Jesus had with His apostles, with the disciples, you think of the fact that on a daily basis, the disciples followed Jesus. And Jesus provided for them. And Jesus told them where to go and what to do. And they didn't have to get up every day and figure out their course of events. They simply followed Jesus. And that ought to be the way, to a great degree, that we as believers live. We ought to understand that with Christ in us, Jesus, God the Holy Spirit, living in us, representing Christ, we ought to understand that that's the reality with which we live, where He is able to provide for us, where He is able to lead, to guide, to direct, to minister to us in the same way that Jesus did. And the Bible says He's expedient. It's expedient for you to go away. And the idea of expedience is not as good as, it's better than. In other words, when Jesus said it's expedient for you that I go away, Jesus said it's better for me to go away than if I were to stay, because of the unique ministry that the Holy Spirit of God has in teaching and guiding into truth. And so we're not preaching on the Spirit this evening, but I see this picture in my mind's eye. I see a picture literally of the map of Patmos and Ephesus and Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Laodicea, and so forth. I see all these churches. Philadelphia, I missed Philadelphia in the midst of that. And I see the churches represented, but I see Jesus standing there larger than the map. And the candlesticks representing the Lord Jesus. Now, I don't want to make too much of this, but the candlestick is somewhat significant in the number 7. Now, we know a lot of things about numbers, but I'll just tell you something. The Bible doesn't say, "Thus saith the Lord, 3 is the day of, 7 is the day of." In other words, we see things that are representative in numbers, but I'll tell you, there's a lot of paganism in taking numbers of the Scripture and making more of them than God does. There is pagan. It is, if a person thinks that you can somehow find prophecy, I got a nutty email this weekend from somebody explaining why Donald Trump's going to be elected using, what's the guy's name that did the whole numbers thing back in the 90s and the numbers of the Bible? And he used all the numbers and explained why Donald Trump would be the next president. I'm just telling you something. I didn't use the word. I sent the guy an email and I regretted it immediately after hitting send. I put words to describe your intellect would be unkind or something like that. So I didn't say that's stupid or asinine or dumb or anything like that. I just simply, and I shouldn't have said that. I thought, well, that wasn't very nice of me. So I sent him an email and said, that wasn't very nice of me. You know, but I'm sorry, that's not, the Scripture's written to be understood. The Bible says, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scriptures of any private interpretation. If some lunatic can come up with prophecy in the Scripture about Donald Trump, I'm promising you no one else will. You know? Which means it's private interpretation. You get that? Okay. So when we approach the Scripture this evening, I'm sorry, my friend, if God told you something in Revelation that no other believer has ever gotten and the Holy Spirit hasn't illuminated anyone else to gather, you've come up with something that is not a prophecy of the Scripture. Are we following me here? In other words, this letter that John wrote to the churches by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, given by the Word of God, is intended to shed light on that which was cloaked or mysterious. It is not to give secrets to pseudo-preachers who may thereby enrich themselves by expounding to you things you would never have figured out on your own, because they don't exist. Okay? So understand, do you understand the mindset or the approach through which we're studying the Scripture? It's written to be understood. God said people that read it and understand it and obey it will have a blessing, and I want the blessing. I'd like that blessing. So it ought to be preached, it ought to be read, and it ought to be understood. All right, let's read our text, chapter 2, verse 1. And we will read this evening down to, let's see here, verse 7. Unto the angel, 7, that's the number of perfection. Let's go back again. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they're apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I'll come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Well, aren't you glad that the tree of life isn't lost? Isn't it wonderful that this is a promise for believers? No, this isn't what we're preaching about this evening. It's just more wonderful information. All right, let's pray. We'll ask the Lord to help us briefly here. And we need help over the long term, but we'll pray briefly and ask the Lord to help us. And I'll try to preach briefly so I don't overwhelm you this evening. Father, thank you for the Scripture. And Lord, we do need your help this evening. God, a lot of things could be preached tonight. There are so many messages in these seven verses. So many things that could be emphasized. But Father, tonight we need for Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church the truths that you want us to glean. And we ask for that now. We ask for your Spirit's power in the preaching. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, in chapter 1 and verse 12, the Bible says, I turned and saw the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. If you were to read down, you'll see this, of course, is the Son of God. This is Jesus Christ. And John would have been personally familiar with the appearance of Jesus, except for the glorification that he sees here would be, you know, the thing that makes him really glow, as white as snow, and his eyes are like a flame of fire. So Jesus is not appearing as a servant of men. He's appearing as the Son of God. And here he is standing. John sees this picture, and I can just envision in my mind's eye. And he's told the outline for the events. Now, friend, one of the things you and I need to understand is that God is a very good grammarian. He's a very sound grammarian. Now, a lot of people don't want to emphasize studying the Scripture and, man, emphasizing words and word order and parts of speech and the exegesis of the same. But I'm just telling you something. God's more intelligent than you are. He developed language. He understands it well enough to confound it. And he understands it well enough that when he says, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. When he says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Or when the Holy Spirit uses Hebrews and other portions in the Scripture to emphasize the tense of a word. Understand, God knows his grammar. And so when every word and every punctuation mark, if you will, every breathing mark in the Scripture is given by inspiration of God, mind you that God is able to know the way that they're given in such a way that you and I can look at them, analyze them, and realize, okay, this fits within this rule of grammar, and so these are the possibilities, and these are the impossibilities. Many Christians like ignorance. Because through ignorance, they may believe what they wish, what they choose. They may take a doctrinal position to align themselves in a way that is expedient for themselves, but is not the way that God would have us to understand doctrine. Know this. There is no private interpretation. And believers who disagree about what the Bible says do not disagree because they cannot agree. They disagree because of choices that they make about how to interpret the Scripture. And so they're not letting the Scripture speak to them as it's written. They're saying, this is what I believe, and then going to the Scripture to rest it, as Peter would say, into what they wanted to say. And we don't want that mindset. We want the attitude of a person that says, God, whatever you say. Listen, if I've always believed this and the Scripture says otherwise, then I don't believe it anymore. I take the position of God. And it isn't about pride. It isn't about I want to always be right. It's about God's always right, and I always want to be with God. And so this is the way we should approach the Scripture. Well, the Scripture is given in tenses in verse 9. The outline of Revelation is given, and it's very well outlined. Write the things which thou hast seen, the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. And so John is to write the things which were past tense, that's past tense, the things which are is present tense, and the things which shall be hereafter is future tense. Everybody understand the tense in verse 19? Are is present tense, right? The things that were is past tense. Did the Holy Spirit make a mistake? No, sir. Now, I want to tell you something. Based on chapter 1 and verse 19 and individuals ignoring this portion of Scripture, casting it out and saying it's not important, individuals get off, I shouldn't say just dispensationally, but they get off in interpreting the future events of the Scripture, and they don't understand the way that this letter is written, and as a result of it, they get off eschatologically. They get off on the end times and understanding the end times. And by the way, there is a major, massive resurgence since I have not seen since the early 1980s of individuals, particularly in Bible preaching circles oftentimes, that have gotten bad eschatology. Very bad eschatology. A lot of people, it's really being propagated right now that the coming of the Lord Jesus to take His saints is not imminent, and that we're going to, if you will, go through the tribulation and go through the judgment that God has for the wicked. It's very popular theology today, but it flies in the face of the grammar of Revelation 1:19. Does not fit, does not work. I will say, as we begin to look at the seven churches specifically, that as you see the last of the church mentioned, which is the church at Laodicea, as you see that church addressed in chapter 4 and verse 1, you don't need to turn there, but as you see, after you see that seventh church addressed, we see the phrase, after this, meaning, okay, this is done. This part is done. Well, friend, let me ask you a practical question. When is the church age?
Right now.
Right now, right? Okay, so what is after the church age? That would be future, right? Okay, so right now is present. And so when we begin chapter 2 and verse 1, can I say to you that according to the Scripture, we're looking at the things which are? When John is saying, write the things which are, and it's addressed to the church, and we're in the church age, does everybody follow this? We're talking about the things which are. You say, Pastor, I don't know how the churches are doing in those places right now. Well, my friend, God promised the candlesticks in those particular churches would be removed. And so, whether those candlesticks are there or whether they're somewhere else, the church age is still going on. So for us, it's present. But when we get to chapter 4 of the revelation of Jesus Christ, mind you, the church is no longer mentioned. The church is never mentioned in Revelation from chapter 4 and forward. The harlot is mentioned, a fake Israel, a fake church. Israel is again mentioned. But the church is gone. You never find the church again after chapter 4 and verse 1. Pastor, what's the significance of that? Well, the significance of it is that the church is not part of the events of the tribulation. The significance of it is that what the Scripture always teaches is true, and that is that judgment is not for the righteous, but judgment is for the wicked. And so those, and I'm not talking about righteous because of our behavior, I'm talking about righteous because of Jesus Christ. God never destroys the righteous. God will chastise believers. But the judgment, the terrible events that are going to happen that will literally destroy the populations of the world that are prophesied beginning in chapter 4 and moving forward, those things, those events are not for the church, my friend. The church will have her place. She'll be part of the 420 elders. She'll be part of that, the scene in the throne room of heaven. But my friend, she will not be part of the events following chapter 4. Did everybody get that? Did everybody understand where I'm coming from? That's not what I'm preaching tonight, but it's so significant that it'll be something we reference occasionally, and it'll be very, we'll reference again when we begin chapter 4, verse 1. In verse 1, the Bible says to write this to the church of Ephesus. And that's interesting because if you were sitting on the Isle of Patmos, I think on a good, clear day, you could actually visibly see Ephesus from Patmos. So Patmos would be an island outlying Ephesus, and I think on a good, clear day, you could visibly actually see Ephesus from Patmos. And so I think it would be certainly appropriate if God is, the Holy Spirit is telling John to write letters to the churches, to begin with them in order proximity. And so that's what we find here. Just check it out and look at it yourself. Again, that's not anything to do with the Scripture, but it's interesting. These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. So who's able to do that?
Jesus.
Jesus. You could say God. God is. Okay? Verse 2. I know thy works. I'm not going to preach a message about that, but God knows. God knows. You know, sometimes believers, don't we get to thinking like God doesn't know? It's too hard. You ever said it's too hard to God? And God says, I know the real deal. I know why it's too hard. You know, it's amazing. I'll be as transparent as I can here because I know you're the same. It's amazing how worn out I can be for the wrong reasons. I don't think I've ever preached the gospel in a way that physically fatigued me. I've never served Jesus and had it wear me out. But I've done things. I've worked hard and gotten worn out. I've done things that have worn me out, but my friend, not when you really examine things and you look at the heart of the motive behind them, the truth of the matter is that God knows our works. He knows the reality of it. I'm always reminded of what Jesus said to the disciples when they returned to bring him food at the well at Samaria when he was sharing the gospel with the Samaritans. And they said, Master, eat. And he said, my meat is to do the will of them that sent me. In other words, they said, well, who fed him already? He wasn't hungry. He said, I don't need to eat. I'm good. I'm covered. And they said, did somebody give him food? Did somebody feed him? And he said, no, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. You're fatigued and you're tired out. It's because you're doing everything but working for Jesus. Did you hear me this evening? If you're fatigued and if you're tired out, it's because you're doing everything but working for Jesus. God will sustain a work that he is in. God will sustain it. I found that to be true in the ministry. I've had people say, oh, Pastor, you've got to watch out for burnout. Well, burnout is something that happens when you're walking in the flesh. It's not something that you do in the Spirit of God. If God's the one whose light is shining, Christ is the light shining, you won't burn out. Your candle will burn bright, but it won't burn out. And so here's the one that says, I know thy works. And we're going to look this evening at three particular words that are connected here. And I think it's important. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And I want to jump down to verse 3. And hast borne and hast... What's the next word?
Patience.
Now, if I were to describe the church at Ephesus based on two words plus another, the word bear there is the same word for patience. So it's the opposite. It's impatient. So if I were to describe chapter 2, and I were to describe simply, tell you what the church at Ephesus is like. Maybe one of you all have been called to the ministry, and you're thinking about it over at Ephesus. Maybe you're one of Timothy's disciples or something. Timothy, you know, pastored at Ephesus. And Ephesus was a place where Apollos had ministered. And Apollos was quite a guy. Matter of fact, Ephesus is the place where Apollos was told about the power of the ministry of God the Holy Spirit. If you were to read, I believe it's Acts chapter 18. Ephesus is where Paul went with Aquila and Priscilla after being at Corinth and really having that year of refreshing ministry at Corinth. Paul went to Ephesus and he met this man Apollos, and he was very learned, he was very eloquent in expounding the Scripture, but he didn't know about the finished work of Christ. They said, well, who are you baptized? What baptism were you baptized with? He said the baptism of John the Baptist. He was certainly a believer. He believed that the kingdom of heaven was at hand when Christ was coming. But he didn't know that Jesus had his ministry and had gone to the cross. He didn't have the full theology. And so they expounded with him, and Apollos became a great minister in the faith. So much so that they knew about him in Corinth, certainly, because you remember when some people said, I'm of Paul and I'm of Apollos? So Apollos was quite a teacher of the Scripture, and he was known internationally for the ministry that God had called him to, and he was from Ephesus. There were a couple of other people at Ephesus, and they were devout Christians, and they were believers in the coming of Christ, but they didn't know Jesus had come yet. And they immediately turned to Christ and they searched the Scriptures. They were much like the Bereans, except not to find out error. It was just they wanted to find out truth. And so that would be the church at Ephesus. And if I were to describe them, if you were maybe going to consider going there to minister to the church at Ephesus, one of the things I'd tell you about is, well, I'll tell you, they're a solid bunch of people. Tell me, Pastor, what are they like? Well, I'll tell you, they're pretty patient. Pretty patient. A guy like Timothy ministering there, and being young in the faith and saying, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers. Well, they would have been good people to be an example for because they were very patient anyway. And maybe Timothy would have been very, very zealous and exuberant, as though that's some kind of a sin. I remember being young and being zealous and exuberant and having people act like that was some kind of a bad thing, you know. And, you know, it's kind of amazing. You know, I wish I had enough energy to be zealous and exuberant. But the fact of the matter is that zeal is a good thing, and a devotion and a love for the Lord. Well, this church at Ephesus were patient people. You want to describe it, you'd say patient. And they were patient and they were impatient. And I like that because it says cannot bear, and the word for bear there is the same word we use for patience, except it's impatient. In other words, you're patient and you're impatient, but the Bible says you cannot bear them which are, say they're apostles, and which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they're apostles and are not. So one thing about the church at Ephesus is you better not be trying to pull the wool over their eyes. You want to show up there and say, I have a message for God from you. They say, who are you? They need to say, well, what's the message? Who are you? Well, I'm an apostle. Oh, really? Well, tell us about it. God called me to be an apostle. And they said, well, you know, Paul wrote a letter to Corinth, and they'd go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And they would read, you know, the Paul's qualification, why he was an apostle. Say, were you an eyewitness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus? They go to Acts chapter 1. Were you an eyewitness of the Lord Jesus in His resurrection? Did you see Jesus Christ physically, His resurrected body? I'm telling you, you know, a lot of Christians today have people walk through, not maybe not this door, but in our past church, walk through the door and said, you know, I'm an apostle. And I said, no, you ain't. I don't have to know you to know you're lying to me. And I know anything else you're about to tell me is a lie. A person who claims to be an apostle doesn't know what the Scripture says about an apostle. You had to physically follow the Lord Jesus, be personally discipled and taught by the Lord Jesus, and be an eyewitness of the resurrected Christ. And any person who claims to have that experience today is a liar. And the church at Ephesus had no patience for that. They said, call yourself an apostle somewhere else, bud. You're not going to come in here with your false doctrine. They'd suffer anything. They'd suffer a slight, maybe somebody's a little slow getting it, a little slow growing. Well, that's all right. You'll get it, brother. Everybody grows at their own pace. Maybe somebody is just constantly, continually needing you. Well, that's all right, brother. They're very patient people, but the contrast is they're very impatient, but they're patient for the right reasons and they're impatient for the wrong reasons. They have no use for false doctrine, and they have all the time in the world for the things that are true. Maybe a task is too difficult or too costly or too whatever. They're patient people. What a wonderful testimony of a ministry. What a wonderful testimony of people and the way that they work towards serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Patient. Patient. You know, I know a lot of Christians that are impatient. They want to know God's will and they want to know it right now. They want their whole life laid out. They don't want to wait on the Lord. They want God to say, do this, 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 and this, and this, and they make decisions on the fly just because they don't have time to wait on the Lord. You say, Pastor, what are you talking about? Well, I've had people before that are impatient, and it's very harmful to them personally. You know, it's real easy to know what I should do today. It's the Lord's Day. You ever read that in the Bible? It's not the Sabbath day, it's the Lord's Day. And what's the precedent on the Lord's Day? Worship the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a real privilege, actually, of the church. It's the first, it's the first great change as far as from what would God establish when He worked 6 days and rested on the seventh. Remember this? God worked 6 days, rest on the seventh, and commanded rest on the seventh day. But when Jesus Christ was risen, it was on the first day of the week, not the seventh day of the week, and that's the Lord's Day. And it's interesting, as John even pens the Scripture here, as the Holy Spirit gives it to him, what's he doing on the Lord's Day? He's in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. And a five-day work week is a Christian concept. Did you know that? Less is a pagan concept and more is a pagan concept. But Christians are the first people that were able to say, well, you know what, I'm going to rest on the Sabbath day and I'm going to worship on the Lord's Day. I've had Christians say, Pastor, it just wears me out going to church on Sunday. Well, I'm going to just tell you something. It's worship is effort. There's effort in worship. Worship is not rest. I promise you that on the average Sunday, when I go home at night, I'm fairly tired. Probably more tired than many of you are on many days. Matter of fact, on Monday, I can barely move because of my Sunday because of the Lord's Day. My Sunday's been, this is the fourth time I've preached today. Fourth time I've preached and taught today. And so that keeps me busy. But I've also been awake all day. I've been interacting and talking, and sometimes more than today. Today's been an easy day in many respects. But you know something I learned a long time ago? The Lord's Day isn't a day of rest. The Sabbath day is a day of rest. And so here's a church that understands that. They know that. And they're patient. They've borne these things. So I've had people that say, well, Pastor, I don't know what I should do with my life. Well, I do. I do. You should be in fellowship with Jesus. You're supposed to be in fellowship. Are you in fellowship with the Lord today? Are you? How do you have fellowship with Jesus? How do you have fellowship with Him? So tell me, I'm asking you.
Read your Bible and pray.
What?
Read your Bible and pray.
Okay, you can read your Bible and pray. So reading your Bible is God talking to you. Praying is you giving requests to God. That's part of fellowship. How else?
Walk in the light as He is in light.
Walk in the light. And that's great. If we walk in light as He is in light, then we have fellowship. Okay, so then what do we have to not have in our lives?
Sin,
okay? If we confess, our 1 John is all about fellowship. If we got sin in our lives, we don't have fellowship with Him. So that robs our fellowship. Okay, what else? How else do we have fellowship? You said walk in the light. How do we do that? Is this how we walk in the light? Or do something? Is this how we walk?
Service.
Huh? What is walking?
It's action.
It's action, right?
Obedience.
So serving God, obeying God. What?
Obedience,
yeah. Somebody finally said it. Thank you. Obedience. God says, do this, I'll do it. What does the Bible say about the gospel? Go. Teach all nations. Baptizing them in the name of the Father. So, let me ask you a question. Is that active or passive? Both. It happens to people and it's done by us. But it requires action, does it not? Now, I'm telling you, you don't accidentally preach the gospel. Oh, I know. God gives opportunities all the time. I thank God. Man, I'll tell you, the last week I've had phone calls, random strangers calling me and just saying, hey, can you tell me something about God? You know, I mean, what a wonderful opportunity. I mean, that just falls in your lap. That's great, but that doesn't always happen that way. You know how I have the opportunity to preach the gospel most of the time? I go find somebody and preach the gospel to them. And oftentimes, the first time I preach it to them, they don't receive it. So you know what I have to do? I have to find them again, and I have to follow through, and I have to make the effort of preaching the gospel. And you know when people get saved, you know that they don't always just get baptized right away. You know how you get people baptized? You help them grow, understand the Scripture, and know that it's an important step of obedience. And then they get baptized. And it's work. I'll tell you something. If you are making the claim that you're serving the Lord, and you're patiently waiting on the Lord, and you're not winning the loss for Jesus Christ and discipling them, you don't have a characteristic of Ephesus. I'll just tell you, Ephesus is a soul-winning church, I promise you. Ephesus was a working church. The word born, what does the word born mean? It means to bear or to carry the load. It's a working bunch of people. They're great people. They're great working people. And God commends them. They're working people. They're patient people. They're impatient people for error. They're patient for working. They're patient for waiting. Patient for working. Patient for waiting. And they're impatient for error. They don't have any use for people teaching error. They try it. They test it. And they say, no, sir, we're not having that. And we have no patience for that. And somebody says, I'm an apostle. And they're not. We have no patience for that. We have no use for that. And so this is their characteristic. Moving forward, we see as well, they labor for my name's sake, has labored. Paco said that they are obedient people. Obedience oftentimes is not, you know, sometimes we think of obedience as sitting. But obedience is very seldom sitting, right? You know, when we think of obedience, a lot of times we think of the sitting, standing illustration, right? Where the little boy is told to sit down and he says, I'm standing up on the inside. You know? In other words, we think of obedience as telling somebody, don't go there, don't do this. But actually, obedience is usually action. Obedience is normally do, you see. Obedience is do this. It's not don't do this. So this is an active church, and the Bible says they've labored and then and has not fainted. In other words, they're not one of these, you know, sprinting ministries that takes off and then gets tired, faints. They're grounded enough, they're steady enough, they're patient enough that if they start out to do a task and you meet them again in a couple years, they'll still be doing it. Well, tell me some characteristics of your church over there at Ephesus. Well, brother, we've been working real hard trying to reach the lost for Jesus Christ. A couple years later. Tell me some characteristics of your church over there at Ephesus. Well, we've been working real hard trying to reach the lost for Jesus Christ. In other words, they haven't fainted. They haven't said, you know, we work so hard at that. Soul winning doesn't work. It's too hard. It's too difficult. Too few people come. Too few people get saved. They just do it. And if you meet the people that are doing it, you meet them years later. I've met a few Christians that I think are Ephesian in characteristic. You know, it's always neat. Maybe you've been in a ministry in years past, and you see somebody and they're serving the Lord. And you go there a few years later, and there they are serving the Lord. And a few years later, you go and they're there serving the Lord. And that's a characteristic of that of those people. It's a characteristic of that ministry. You get the idea of stability here. You get an idea of steadfastness. There's no rebuke from the Lord Jesus for any of these things. This is desirable in a church, and it's characteristic. By the way, Christian, that'll be desirable for us. You know, it somewhat troubles me that our ministry is 10 years old and my wife and I are the last originals. Now, some of y'all have been here for quite a while. Several of you have been with us for quite a while. But it's somewhat troubling to me that a lot of people just burn out. They just tire out. They just fizzle out. They just can't make it. You know, it's just, well, you know what? It's just too hard. I heard a lot of people say it's too hard to make it in Fort Lauderdale. How many ever heard that? It's too hard to make it in Fort Lauderdale. But what you need is a little bit of patience. Most people don't make it long enough to make it. Most people don't last long enough to get in a situation where they can make it. Because, why? Well, because it's hard. And you have to be patient when it's hard. And that's the church at Ephesus. And God give us some people like that. God give us some people that know well enough what God wants to say, I know what God wants, and it doesn't matter if it takes a lot of patience. I'll have patience. It doesn't matter if it's fast or slow. I'm going to go steadily along. I'm going to plod along, and I'm going to see what God will do. Moving forward, we see more characteristics. The Bible says, we see the rebuke, and we will see this outline in every one of the churches. We'll see God's commendation to the church with a couple of exceptions, and then we'll see the rebuke. The Bible says, nevertheless, I have, and the word somewhat in your scripture, you'll notice, is italicized, meaning that there are not two words for it, but the word is encapsulated in the against. So it's not I'm against you, but I have somewhat, I have a little bit. The idea is a measured amount against you. I'm kind of against you. And the idea here is more of, you know, I'm not saying you are everything you ought to be. There's a little bit that isn't right here. I have somewhat against thee, and the answer, and the what is against them is because they've left, because thou hast left thy first love. Because thou hast left thy first love. I have a few comments here, and we'll be finished momentarily. Probably, if you've heard a message on the church at Ephesus, this is what you've heard about, and it's because it's the main sense of the Scripture here. And God's issue with Ephesus, it's not a major rebuke, it's not open sin, but it's just that you're doing it, but you're not loving it. You're doing it, but you're not loving it. And Christian, God wants you to love it. God wants you to love it. You're teaching a Sunday school class, God wants you to love teaching a Sunday school class. You're going soul winning, God wants you to love soul winning. Are you investing in other Christians' lives? God wants you to love investing in other Christians' lives. You know, it's a wonderful thing when we get from the point of conviction to the point of action, isn't it? From knowing we ought to do something and actually doing it, and then getting experienced enough that we actually know how to do it. It's a refreshing thing. I remember preparing for the ministry and wanting to train and disciple and mentor people and thinking, I don't know how to do that. Well, thank God a lot of the not knowing how days are past. It's not as hard, but I'll tell you something, doesn't mean you always love it. Just because you're doing it doesn't mean you love it, and God wants you to love it. He wants you to love the ministry. You know, you wouldn't have a problem with people if you love the ministry. You love the Lord Jesus, you love the ministry, and you wouldn't have a problem with people. People wouldn't bother you or upset you. You wouldn't be picking and griping at them. You'd love the ministry, so you'd love them. It wouldn't be an issue. You wouldn't focus on the things that are bad in their lives. Oh, you wouldn't have patience for evil. You'd be impatient with the evil in their lives. But you wouldn't have a problem with personalities and all these things that come up in churches where people don't like each other and they don't have a scriptural, biblical reason why there's a problem, or they got to make up something to have a problem with. It's all because you don't love. You don't love the ministry. You love the ministry, you love people. And God has somewhat against them. God's a little bit against that ministry because they don't love like they used to love. Now, the introduction to the letter said that there's a blessing for the people that read and the people that hear. And Christian, if the scripture here is indicating that a church that doesn't have the love it used to have is blessed, what might be the implication? Did I say implication? Implication. If that same ministry doesn't love like it used to. You know, you could be really sound in doctrine. You can have devoted, careful, patient people, and God can be a little bit against you if you left your first love. If you've left your first love, you're loving something instead. Something has taken the place of priority over the thing that God wants you to love. Oftentimes it's a relationship, sometimes it's an interest, sometimes it's a disinterest. But if that's so, God's a little bit against you, which means He's a little bit not blessing you. We're not just talking about an individual, I'm talking about a church. You know, God's blessing is more than finances as well, folks. But you want to look at a church and you see a church that has a lack of God's blessing, it probably, quite likely, is like the church at Ephesus. You can't find anything else wrong. You're just like, I just don't see God blessing there. Well, if they're a patient church and if they're sound in doctrine, which means they're intolerant of false doctrine, there's a real good chance they've left their first love. Matter of fact, and I'm just trying to be as transparent, as honest as I can, if I were to pick out a church that Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church is very similar to, I'd say it's Ephesus. Because we got a bunch of great people, but I'm not sure we love the way we did when we first came to Jesus. I'm not sure we have that freshness, that zeal, that youthful love, that first love. I'm not saying I know anybody that's going through this right now, but when a guy meets a girl and begins talking to her, it seems like they talk very frequently.
A lot.
And very often, and it's what they want to do. First love. And the same is true when you love the Lord Jesus and you love the ministry. And when you get married and you realize, care if we talk or not. I'm not saying I realize that. You realize, you know, I didn't spend time with her today. You think, well, and there's no regret in it, or no, man, that's makes a lousy day. Well, you've left your first love. You don't have that same love. First love means that love you had first. I'm not talking about passion, attraction. I'm not talking about, you know, when I'm talking about the physical aspect of it, the excitement, from the unknown or the mystery of it. I'm just talking about the interest. The interest. When we talk about reading the scripture and you see it as a duty, rather than an opportunity, when we talk about participating in ministry opportunities and you see it as taking away from something else rather than an opportunity to do something that hasn't opened up before, you've left your first love. So here we see in the scripture a very good, clear indication of God's having somewhat against the church at Ephesus In other words, rather than God's blessing, actually God's countenance being against a little bit. When I pray about it and I look at these matters, I say, well, here's a diagnostic. Here's a diagnosis. I'd say we're Ephesian in a lot of ways in our ministry. So I would say that we need to look at the final part and conclude here momentarily. Verse 5, God says, remember from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works. In other words, remember where you came from and go back there. It's interesting for people who like to take repentance and create some salvific doctrine out of it, that the word here doesn't have to do with salvation. God isn't saying to the church at Ephesus, you need to get saved again. Right? Is he? Is that what repentance is here? No, repentance is going back to the way things were. Repentance here is returning to the place that you fell from. And in this instance, the word fallen is used. It's interesting because the word fallen means to go down. And so the idea is to climb back up. Get back up. You're on a horse, you fall, you get back up. Get back on. It's the idea of remember and repent. The idea of repentance here is go back. Go through the effort. Hey, you may have to go through some effort of actually going through the steps that it took to get where you were. That's a shame, actually, isn't it, when we're talking about growth, that we talk about falling. It's too bad because in growth, you always want to grow. You always want to increase. But here we see some decreasing aspects, and that's the church at Ephesus. It's a diminished church. It's just not quite what it was. Oh, they're laboring. Oh, they're patient. Oh, they're impatient. Oh, they're bearing. They're all the things, but they're not what they were. Not what they were. And God says, repent. And then He gives a warning. He said, or else I'll come unto thee quickly and remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. God is not saying, my suggestion would be in order to return to my blessing, it might be in your best interest to repent. No, God said, if you don't repent, I'll snuff you out. I'll close the door, close the book. My friend, a church that's patient with good and patient for evil has a God which is impatient of them not loving Him. Isn't that a rather stern warning when you think about it? I'll just tell you something. If you were to go to Ephesus and you were to evaluate the ministry there, you would not be able to put your finger on a single thing that indicates that there's a major problem. But God said, you don't love like you used to. And that's such a problem that if you don't correct it, I'll wipe you out. I'll take the candle. Christian, on an individual level, is just as true as it is on a corporate ecclesia or assembly level. If you don't love Jesus like you used to, you better get back. Better get back. Oh, this isn't God saying, I'm going to destroy you with fire and brimstone. No, this is God saying, okay, you don't want to live for me, you don't want to love me, I'll just take your opportunity away. Never occur to you that God made you for a reason? You're not here just to consume oxygen and create carbon dioxide. God has a purpose and a plan for your life. Your first purpose is realized when you come to know Jesus as your Savior. God created you so that you could receive Christ. When you receive Jesus, God didn't save you so that you could occupy space on God's green earth. He saved you so you could serve Him, so you could love Him, so you could live for Him. If you've lost that, if you've left that, God's very impatient with you at this stage of the game. You know the tragedy of it is when somebody has something that belongs to you. You ever had that happen? Maybe because of a whiny attitude or pouting or something. Somebody, you got passed over for something. I remember when, I don't know how old I must have been. I think I must have been about 5 or 6. My little cousin Brian was born. And he was my uncle Jean and Aunt Luann's baby, their firstborn. And they were the cool aunt and uncle that didn't have kids. and they used to come and throw us around and, you know, have a lot of fun. They were wonderful. And they had a baby, and they lived out in western Kansas, and I really wanted to see their baby. I was pretty excited about him being born. And I kept asking, when are we going to go see him, when are we going to see him, to the point where I started getting teased about it. And then my parents wouldn't tell me when we were going to get to see him. And so I got frustrated, and I said, well, I don't even care. I don't even want to see him at all. And so a couple weeks later, we went to see him. He's a little bitty baby, and I wanted to hold him, wanted to see him. And everybody there, my cousin Rocco, my Aunt Lois, my mom, my dad, my brother, my sister, said, Ryan, you said you didn't want to see him. So here I sat there and didn't look. That was the thing I wanted really badly. I wanted to see my little cousin, wanted to hold him. That's why I hate holding babies to this day. I got emotionally scarred. Not really. I remember my Uncle Gene coming over and everybody's holding him and everything and saying, you know, you're going to miss a chance to hold him. It's about time to go home that night and I hadn't held him yet. You're going to miss a chance just because you're upset. Now, they shouldn't have teased a little boy like that. It wasn't nice. It was probably provoking. I'm still angry about it. Not really. But you know, sometimes we miss a pretty good opportunity just because of whatever it is. You get to look around and see everybody else in that place. You know God's work's going to go on. We're called you to preach and you won't preach. God will have somebody else preach instead of you and you'll have to watch. God called you to teach and you won't teach because it's something you're mad about or pouting about or upset about. You have to watch somebody else do something God called you to do. Whereas God will just say, all right, I'm done with you. I got somebody else for that. I created them to take place. You know, it matters. It matters that you do what you're made to do. If you won't do what you're made to do, God says, well, I'm very impatient with that. And if you don't repent, if you don't turn back to it, I'll take your chance away. And that'll be that. And so I hope this evening, as we begin to look at the churches and we begin to look at future, before we go to the future events, we look at the present tense, we look at God's heart toward His church, I hope we'll find some personal application. Not just on a church level, but on a personal level. And that is that God is very impatient with individuals who, you know, do everything the right way, but they don't love. They don't love Him. They don't love the ministry. They don't love the things they used to love. And God says, repent. I want you to go back to it. And if you don't go back to it, very swiftly, very quickly, I'll come to you and I'll remove your candlestick. And your chance will be over. I'll pass you by. And as I look at this all, I just think, you know, it'd be a lot better not to lose your love at all. One, you don't want to be in the danger, and two, you don't want to miss anything in the meanwhile, in the intermission. And that's where we find our application in Revelation tonight. Father, thank you for what you've taught us in the Scripture. I pray that you'd help us to add to it, continue to learn it. And Father, as we have opportunity this week, help us to practice and live it out for Jesus Christ. We pray in His name. Amen. You're dismissed.